Beautiful. take our families away from places that are familiar and move to places that are far off.
My wife was 9 months pregnant, and we did not know one person who lived in the city.
Why don't we come to where there's nothing so we can try and start something?
The Lord really just, He broke my heart for this city before I stepped off the plane.
Why do we stress and strain and struggle and sweat just to make life better for someone else?
There's so many people that are broken, that are lost, and it's heartbreaking.
Yes, sometimes people ask why, and when they do, we tell them there's places where the truth hasn't yet reached.
We need to share the gospel and teach our local community.
We tell them there's a God who loves them so much, He sent us.
God spoke to us, broke our hearts for the city, and God's culture is all.
And we tell them there are people who love them so much. They give so that we can go.
When people give to mission, things happen. New believers are getting baptized. New churches are started.
So when people ask why, that's what we tell them. We tell them it's the gospel. It's all about the gospel.
Church. Obviously, I'm not with Jim. He is celebrating his anniversary this week, and they are away. We are in good hands this morning. I just want to thank you for being here. Hello, Facebook. Glad to see you all. These campus students. We're going to have a really good morning. I just want to go over a few announcements before we begin. As you know, today is Palm Sunday. Next Sunday, Easter, we're doing things a little bit different. We're going to be having two services, one at 8:30 and one at 10:45. That will give us a little bit more time to do what we need to do. You are welcome to come to both, either, but that's what Jim says. No, it's not an option. We encourage you to be here for that. That's what we're going to do as a Savior. I just want to welcome you to this morning as a part of share. Thank you for the community you can pray for. You were set free, you were released. And I look forward to hearing your message this morning exactly in your heart. I think I'll say that if you are our guest this morning with us, you ask us to take out your bulletin out and tear out that book section, fill it out, and we'll build your record of your visits so we can send you.
today. Isn't that great? Amen. Praise the Lord. And I know God has much ahead for you and your family. We remember Annie Armstrong. You have a goal of $2,000. I'm praying that y'all take up at least about $4,000. How about that? That'd be pretty good, wouldn't it?
Amen.
If we continue to think of our offerings and what God means to us. Brother Jim had asked me what I was prepared to bring. I said, well, I'm probably even going to do a message on the triumphant victory of the Lord Jesus or on the crucifixion of Christ. And that'll pave the way for next Sunday, which I like to call Resurrection Sunday.
Amen.
And so we can come together. But, you know, really, every Lord's Day is Resurrection Sunday.
That's right. It is.
Because the resurrection is what it's all about, is it not?
Amen.
There have been many religious folks that have come and gone. Many have died and have been buried. But only one has died, buried, and resurrected from the dead. And that is the Lord Jesus. So what an honor and privilege it is to be with you this morning. A few familiar faces are here, and it's always good to have our brothers and sisters in Christ in our midst. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to John chapter 12. John chapter 12, I was preparing for this message to preach on the triumphal entry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And basically, the Lord just captured my attention to three verses. So basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to those three verses, which is the prelude just before Jesus and his apostles come in to Jerusalem. We know that prior in that route, as Jesus and his apostles come to Jerusalem, he comes to the city of Jericho. And there, as he comes to the outskirts of the city, he heals a blind man. Actually, there were two there. Matthew records that there were two blind men, but in Mark's account and the other accounts, we know we identified that it was Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus. Jesus anointed his eyes, and he was able to see. He takes that journey of about 17 miles from Jericho towards Jerusalem, which is one of the most dangerous routes you can take at those particular times. And he lodges there on the Sabbath day at Mary, Martha, and Lazarus' home there in Bethany. And we know the next morning he gets up with his disciples and he comes into Jerusalem, which is on a Sunday morning. And that's why we call the Sunday before the Resurrection Sunday, Palm Sunday, and we'll identify that within this particular text. So we find that Jesus is about to enter into the city that night before. He's in the home, Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And I want to kind of break in chapter number 12, and I want to read verses 9, 10, and 11. And this is just prior to them going the next morning into the city of Jerusalem, the triumphal entry. Now, you and I realize that there are some accounts within the gospel accounts that are found in all four gospels. Anytime you have any other literature on an account or an event, you always need to go back and read all of the accounts, because all of the authors that God used, much of the time, there'll be little nits and bits within those portions of Scripture that if we don't go back and look at them, we'll miss some of the flavor of the context of what is going on. So we know when we think of accounts that are in all four Gospels, we know the baptism of Jesus is in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then we come to what we call the feeding of 5,000. And that also is found in all four Gospels. We come to the triumphal entry, which is in all four Gospels. The death and burial of Christ was in all four Gospels. And the resurrection of Christ was in all four Gospels. And so I invite you to read the account of the triumphal entry in the other Gospels. But basically, as we're about to go in, I want us to center on what is said in chapter 12 of John, verses 9, 10, and 11. And the Bible says, and this is in the home of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. Much people of the Jews, therefore, knew that he was there, talking about Jesus. And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death. Why is that? Verse 11. Because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Let's pray. Father, as we think of your triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Lord, may we go back to the night before as he's in the home of Martha and Mary and Lazarus. And Lord, as we look at the influence, Lord, not only of you, but of Lazarus, and we think of the influence of Martha and Mary, I pray, Lord, that as we get ready for Resurrection Sunday, Father, that you would touch our hearts, our minds, illuminate us, and help us, Lord, get a glimpse of what is going on just prior to the beginning of what we call Passion Week. Father, I pray if there's anyone that is watching by way of Facebook or YouTube, I pray if there's anyone in this sanctuary that is lost, Lord, that you would indeed invade their hearts and minds, reveal to them their sin, and that the only remedy for sin is the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that many would be saved. I ask an anointing of all of the preachers that will be preaching this day. Some of them in various time zones have already preached. Many will be hereafter, and I pray that you'd be with each one of them. Lord, thankful for the many brothers and sisters in Christ we will receive, Lord, that we'll never see on this side, but we will when we cross over to be with you. So, Lord, I pray that you would bless us, illuminate us, enlighten us, and help us that we might get a glimpse of the Lord Jesus Christ anew this morning. And we'll give you all the praise for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. When I think of the influence that Lazarus has made upon many people in the Promised Land, I was thinking of this as I was trying to move past verses 9, 10, 11 and go into verses 12 to 19, which gives us the account of the triumphal entry of the Lord Jesus Christ. We call today Palm Sunday, and the reason we call it Palm Sunday is because of verse 13 in this chapter. Notice verse 13. It says that they took branches of palm trees, and they went forth to meet him, crying, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now in Matthew's account, we find that as Jesus and his disciples come into the city, that they threw down garments and branches. We don't know what kind of branches they are, but they're garments and branches. When we come to Mark's account, Mark also identifies and gives us the information that when they came into the city, they threw down garments and branches. Well, when we come to Luke's account, we find that Luke only identifies that they threw down garments. But when we come to John's account, we find that it identifies what kind of branches they were. And so it tells us in verse 13 that they're palm branches. And so thereby we derive the title Palm Sunday for the Sunday because before the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if anyone ever asks you, why do we call it Palm Sunday? You can go to John 12, verse 13, and show them why that this particular Sunday is called Palm Sunday. So when we find Jesus has come into the city, but prior to that, he's at the home of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And we notice the testimony and the influence of Lazarus to many, many individuals that live within the Promised Land. When we think of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and the Acts of the Apostles, we realize that we are to live a life of influence. There's no doubt of that when we read through the four Gospels and the book of Acts, that you and I are to influence those in whom we come in contact with. And I would simply ask the question this morning, what kind of influence am I, not so much when I'm in church or assembled in the church, but what kind of influence am I when I am amongst other individuals? I want us to think about that as we look at Lazarus within these three verses of Scripture. Now, when we come to the Bible, we realize that there are two Lazaruses in the Bible. And both of these Lazaruses are in the New Testament. The first Lazarus, I usually call him Lazarus number one, is found in Luke's Gospel, chapter 16. And there we have the account of the rich man and Lazarus. Now, this Lazarus was a beggar. And this Lazarus was placed at the gate of the rich man looking for crumbs. And so we have the account of what happened to Lazarus when he died. When he died, he was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. Remember that, you go back and read in Luke 16. Abraham's bosom is a synonymous term for heaven. It's a Jewish term, it means heaven. So if you ask a Jew, what does Abraham's bosom mean? It means heaven. So we're talking about heaven. So Lazarus went to heaven, but we find that the rich man went to hell. And so we find that in that providence, God opened the door whereby that this rich man was able to talk to Abraham. And he asked that Abraham send Lazarus back to his city and abode when he had five brothers. And of course, Abraham said that they had the law of the prophets. If they don't believe the law of the prophets, they would not believe no one was sent back from the dead. That's the first Lazarus. But this Lazarus that we find in our text is Lazarus number two. And Lazarus number two is the brother of Mary and Martha. And we know that the Bible is very plain when it talks about these three individuals, these two sisters and one brother, Lazarus being the brother, that the Lord Jesus certainly loved them. People ask me, does the Lord love me? I said, well, I don't know if the Lord loved you. I don't know if the Lord loved me. But I tell you some folks in the Bible that I know that he loves, because in chapter 11, which in chapter 11 we find Lazarus mentioned by name six times, and then in chapter 12 we find this same Lazarus mentioned by name five times. So 11 times by name in chapter 11 and 12 of John, we have the name Lazarus. And so we find in chapter 11, verse number 3, if you want to just back up there just one page, it says, therefore his sister sent unto him, remember Lazarus is sick, and they say, Lord, behold, him whom thou lovest is sick. Now look at verse 5, very, very quickly. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister, that would be Mary, and Lazarus. So the Bible is very plain that Jesus loved this family in a special way. And we know that in chapter 11 that Lazarus was not only sick, but he died. And then 4 days after he died, Jesus came and raised him from the dead. Been dead 4 days. That is Lazarus number two, and this is the Lazarus that we're looking at in chapter 12 of John's Gospel. And in chapter 12, we'll find Lazarus mentioned five times. And here in our text, we see that Lazarus is a tremendous influence to those that are around him. And many of those that knew Lazarus, especially after he was raised from the dead, Lazarus was very irritating to them, okay? And we're going to notice that within our text. So basically, when we put all this together and we think about the influence not only Jesus has over his children, not only did Lazarus have over those that not only witnessed him being raised from the dead, but even the testimony that permeated way farther than just the promised land, to many that heard of what Jesus had done in performing this wonderful miracle. I want us to realize when we look at Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the book of Acts, that we are to be an influence in our life. The Bible tells us in the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13, that we are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its savor, where shall it be salted? It is good for nothing but to be cast out and trodden under the foot of men. So salt is a preservative influence. So we know that salt preserves, and Jesus has commanded that all of his children, not just his apostles and those immediate disciples, but all of his children are to be the salt of the earth. So you and I are to be a preserving influence. I believe Lazarus, it shows us that he was. But not only that, we find that Jesus commands us and tells us that we are the light of the world. And we preserving influence. We want to be an illuminating influence. And then we know that Jesus is the bread of life. And so we are to be a sustaining influence. I tell you what, when I finish this message this morning, there's going to be some folks that are going to be hungry. And if I try to preach everything that I went over this past week, we'd probably be here all day. But we're going to try to look at the influence of Lazarus to those that he comes in contact with. So you and I are going to be a preserving influence. That's seen by the salt. We want to be a sustaining influence. That's seen by the bread of life, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. We want to be an illuminating influence. That is seen by the fact that Jesus is the light of the world, and we are called to be the light. But then we want to be an ongoing influence. When we come to Genesis chapter 4, we find the first murder. And there Cain slew his brother Abel. And we find that Abel, we have reference to Abel in the book, the Hall of Faith in Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 4. And there it tells us that Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. And he bare his testimony that he was righteous. And it goes on to say in the latter part of Hebrews 11, 4, that though Abel be dead, yet he speaketh. So his ministry, Abel's ministry, is an ongoing ministry. It's an ongoing influence. Amen? And he's been gone now a little over 6,000 years. But you know what? Every time that I read about Abel in the Old Testament and New Testament, I realize that Abel still has a ministry going on today. And it's an ongoing ministry. So I want to be a preserver. I want to be a sustainer as a child of God. I want to be an illuminator. And I want to be ongoing wherever I'm at. That means not just when I'm around believers, but most especially when I'm around unbelievers. So we find Lazarus, and I was just to center for a few moments on Lazarus. Remember, this is Lazarus number 2 that is found only in John's Gospel, chapter 11 and chapter 12. 11 times named by name. Lazarus number 1, he's only found in the Gospel of Luke. And I believe that though that account is in parabolic form, I believe that that's an actual account. And I believe right now, as I'm preaching, I believe there is a rich man in hell right now that is suffering the torments of hell. And I believe right now there's a beggar by the name of Lazarus, which, by the way, Jordan, he's not a beggar anymore. Amen.
That's right.
And he's in heaven with the Lord Jesus Christ. I kind of want to talk to him when I go up to be with the Lord. How about y'all? There's a lot of folks I'd like to talk to. I think I'd like to talk to Job and Noah. Certainly want to talk to David and so many others. And probably after I have sat at the feet of Jesus for a million years, I'll probably get up and try to find some of those other folks. Maybe I'll go see Mama after I've been at the feet of Jesus for about a million years. I want you to think about that thought, because that's really what it's all about. Amen. Heaven is Jesus. Amen. Isn't that right? And wherever Jesus is, wherever he is, that's where I want to be, okay? And so we think of Lazarus. And notice the testimony that we find in Lazarus. Let's look at Lazarus just a few moments. In verse number 10 of our text, and I only have 3 verses, so I've given you a lot of background, we find that Lazarus frustrated much of the crowd. He frustrated much of the crowd. Look, if you will, in verse number 10. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death. Now the chief priests, not talking about just priests, but the chief priests, and we think of those within the Sanhedrin, those that we would attribute to be men of God, they wanted to put Lazarus to death. Now Lazarus did not have any credentials at all until he was raised from the dead by the Lord Jesus Christ. His name would mean absolutely nothing if it were not for the fact that Jesus raised him from the dead. Amen? But because Jesus raised him from the dead, and there were many witnesses that saw it, when Mary and Martha, his two sisters saw him raised from the dead, but because others, according to this text, were present when Lazarus was raised from the dead, we find that that was a catalyst that God used to point many lost people to the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see that that Lazarus was a thorn in the flesh to many of the religious hierarchy of the day. They couldn't take it. They hated him, and the Bible identified that they wanted to put him to death. So he frustrated many, but on the other side of the coin, he was an illuminator, he was a preserver, he was exercising his ongoing ministry and influence, and he was a sustainer of his influence when he got around other folks. Amen? So we realize there's always two kinds of folks. There are those that bow to Christ, and there are those that do not. Amen? And sad to say, there are so many that do not. There are many in this community that are within the voice of this New Testament church that are still in their sins, and they're on the road to hell. They need to be saved. Amen? And the only way they can be saved is by the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me." You don't go to heaven because of the church, or the preacher, or the deacons, or the staff, or the programs, or your marriage. You go to heaven because of the grace of God ministered through the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? And the only reason I'm going to heaven is because of Christ. I'm thankful that He gave me faith. I'm thankful that He gave me the gift of repentance, whereby I can turn from my sins and trust the Lord Jesus to be my King, my Lord, and my Savior. I'm thankful that He did that. And there's people in this community that you need to share the gospel with to confront them with the fact that apart from Jesus, they will remain in their sins. And if they remain in their sins, if they stay in hell, they're going to perish in those sins. So we've got to be very, very dedicated to be the influence when we leave this particular gathering of believers and go out in the highways and the byways. So we see, first of all, in verse 10, there is a frustrated crowd. But then secondly, we see that Lazarus is a fruitful Christian. Lazarus is fruitful. Lazarus is a preserver. He's a sustainer. He's an illuminator. And he exercises an ongoing ministry. And you and I have been called to do the same thing as we look at the life of Jesus. As a matter of fact, it tells us in 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 6 that you and I, the children of God, we are to walk the same way Jesus walked. Amen? You know what that means? That means wherever I go, I need to act like Jesus. Amen? People need to see Jesus in me. Now, I'm here to tell you, there's a lot of times I'm afraid people don't see Jesus in me. Amen? That's what Paul was talking about when he said to walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary words to the other, so that you cannot do that which you would do. So how much of every day are you in the flesh? I mean, what? You get the flesh quick, amen? Isn't that right? I mean, just that quick. And are we in the flesh or are we in the Spirit? Now, we're going to be one or the other all day, every day, isn't that right? So how much of the day am I walking in the Spirit? I would be walking in the footsteps of Jesus. I would be looking like Jesus, acting like Jesus, telling others about Jesus, but how many times am I in the flesh? I tell folks, if you come by the house and I'm working on a car, it might be a good idea if you not get out of your car. you'd love to hear a nasty word or two, amen? Now, am I the only one that ever has a problem like that?
No.
I think the apostle Paul had a problem like that, didn't he? Because he said, the things that I hate to do, those are the things that I find myself doing. And the things that I know to do, I find that I'm not doing. And you read that in Romans chapter 7. And when Paul wrote Romans, he had been a child of God about 26 years. He didn't just fall off the turning page. And he still had a problem with indwelling sin within his we go. Well, let's look at his experience. Look at the experience of Lazarus here. We see in verse number 9, much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only. Now they came to see Jesus. They came because Jesus was there, but not just to see Jesus. Many of those folks came to their home to see Lazarus as well. Amen. Because the Lord else said, but that they might see Lazarus also. So they came knowing Jesus was there. They came to see Christ, but they also came to see Jesus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the experience that Lazarus had back in chapter 11 was that he was sick and that he died, and Jesus waited around for 4 days to go raise him from the dead. Now, Lazarus was raised from the dead. He was not resurrected from the dead. The only one that has ever been resurrected from the dead is the Lord Jesus Christ. One of the attributes of a resurrected, glorified body is that that body will never, ever die again. And we have 9 occasions in the Old Testament and the New Testament where there were those that were raised from the dead. But see, those that were raised from the dead, with the exception of the resurrection of Christ, they lived a lot longer and died again. Okay, everybody with me on that? But a resurrected body that is resurrected from the dead, not just raised from the dead, but resurrected from the dead, is a body that never, ever will die again. It is a body that has been glorified. And I hear preachers all the time talking about the resurrection of Lazarus. And I try to get to them and say, don't use that. Just say that he was raised from the dead. He was not resurrected because he does not hold the attributes of a resurrected body. Jesus is the first fruit of the resurrection. And one day, if you're in Christ, you're going to get a body just like Jesus' body. And as a matter of fact, everybody's going to get a resurrected body one day. And those that die in Adam will get a resurrected body that will burn forever and ever in the lake of fire. Amen? Those in hell right now, the rich man that you find in Luke chapter 16, he is in hell right now burning, but he's burning soulishly. His body's still in the tomb, right? So the rich man's body is in the tomb. His soul is in hell in torment. But when he gets a resurrected body, those that get the resurrected body at the judgment at the last day, the dead in hell is cast then into the lake of fire. And now soul and body will burn forever and forever in the lake of fire. I'll tell you what, if you are lost, I would encourage you to apply to Christ and be saved, because if you die in Adam, your soul's going to go to hell. When the resurrection of the body takes place, you're going to get a resurrected body, and then body and soul will burn in the lake of fire forever and forever and forever. So if you do not know Christ as Lord and Savior, I would certainly invite you to apply to Christ and be saved. Amen. Because he is the only Savior. And by the way, we're not saved from hell or the lake of fire. We are saved from our sins. Remember when the angel of the Lord said to Joseph, talking about the babe that was in the womb of Mary, she shall bring forth the son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from hell. Is that what it said? Don't say that, does it? He shall save his people from sin. Folks, hell is not my problem. My problem is my sin. Amen? And my sin must be washed away. And the only way my sin can be washed away is through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? And I'm thankful that his blood washes away all of my sin. So we see that he had an experience. He'd been raised from the dead. But notice his living. Verse number 9. Back up to verse 9. Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there, and they came not for Jesus' sake only, but they might see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So we see that Lazarus, because he had been raised from the dead, not resurrected from the dead, but raised from the dead, that means that he was raised from the dead to live a while. We don't know how much longer he lived, how many more years or months God gave him, but we know later on he died again, all right? So that's the difference between being raised from the dead and being resurrected from the dead. And Jesus is the first fruit of them that sleep, those that their body is in the tomb. And always, when you look at the resurrection, the word resurrection in the New Testament, it's always attributed to the physical body. The physical body. Now, I know we've been resurrected spiritually when our spiritual man has been resurrected from the dead. But when you see the word resurrected itself in Scripture, it is always identified with the body. So we have the resurrected body of Christ that is glorified, and everyone in Christ that dies in Christ, well, one day when the Lord comes back, they'll get a brand new resurrected body just like his body. So he has influence around the people that he comes in contact with. How do you know that? Because not only did the people come to see Jesus in verse number 9, but they also come to see Lazarus, who had been raised from the dead. Now, it is amazing, and I want you to think about this. I want you to think about the influence that Lazarus had on, I'm going to say, hundreds and hundreds of people. Those that were present when he was raised from the dead, and those that had heard about it thereafter. Do you realize that in the 15 times that Lazarus is named by name in Scripture, 6 times by name in chapter 11, and 5 times by name in chapter 12 of John, 11 times Lazarus, this is Lazarus number 2, is mentioned by name. And we think of the influence. Do you realize that in the Bible, in the only 2 chapters where Lazarus is seen, chapter 11 and 12 of John's Gospel, Lazarus does not say one word. There's not one word that came out of Lazarus' mouth that is recorded in the Word of God. Absolutely. I mean, there in the house with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, go back and read it. Go back and read all of chapter 11, all of chapter 12, and you'll notice that not one word of his testimony by speech is found concerning Lazarus. Now, let me give you another point. Think of this. Lazarus, number one, remember the rich man and Lazarus? And the rich man was cast into hell, and Lazarus was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. Lazarus, number one, in Luke 16, not one word is recorded in the Word of God having come from the mouth of Lazarus, number one, go back and read it, or in Lazarus, number two. What kind of influence today is Lazarus number one? We usually use Lazarus number one when we preach on the doctrine of hell. And I fear we better start preaching more about hell than what we've been doing lately. Amen or amen? Amen. That was mighty weak. Can you do better than that? Amen or amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we have the influence that Lazarus gives us, Lazarus number one gives us, that never spoke a word. Now, I tell you, the rich man, he's moaning and groaning and bellyaching and crying to Abraham and talking to Abraham and begging him to send Lazarus back to talk to his 5 brothers. But not one word out of the mouth of Lazarus number one, not one word out of the mouth of Lazarus number two. What kind of influence do those 2 Lazarus hold today, yet they never said a word recorded in Scripture? And here's another one you can add to your list, and that's Abel. Abel is not recorded in Scripture as ever saying one word. Not one. Cain, he talks. He's recorded when he talks to God, when God asks him, are you my brother's keeper? And he talks and bellyaches about he's going to be cursed and somebody's going to kill him and everything else. But not one word in the Word of God is attributed from the voice of Abel, Lazarus number one, or Lazarus number two. And notice the influence that these 3 individuals make even today in an ongoing ministry and have never said a word. Now, does that mean they couldn't talk? Well, certainly they could talk.
But God never put one word out of their mouth in Holy Writ. Isn't that amazing? What kind of influence can a person make for Jesus if they can't even speak? Well, think of Abel, Lazarus number one, and Lazarus number two. And then lastly, in verse 10 and 11, we find that Lazarus' influence, he was antagonistic. Look at verse 11. Why did they want to put him to death? Because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Look at verse 17. The people therefore that was with him when he called Lazarus out of the grave and raised him from the dead, bear record. Underline those two words, bear record. The testimony of Lazarus being raised from the dead from the Lord Jesus Christ, that record still stands today. How many sermons have ever been preached using Abel as an illustration and a type of Christ? How many messages have ever been preached using Lazarus number one in Luke chapter 16? How many messages have ever been preached using chapter 11 and chapter 12 of John's gospel? And yet we find that the influence moves on and on. Lazarus was a threat to the religious hierarchy of his day. Lazarus was a threat to the chief priest and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all of those that we would say if there's anyone that are men of God, it should be these folks. These are those that are in the Sanhedrin. These are they that teach and preach the word of God. Here's the chief priest and all that goes on, and yet these are the very ones that was antagonized by the testimony of Lazarus, this great saint of God. I tell you, I want to talk to him. Are you a threat? Are you a threat to religious society today? When you go in various places, do you offend those that would deny the Lord Jesus Christ? Are you a threat to anybody? That might be the better question to ask this morning. When I go out, do people see Jesus in me? Do they bear record that I have been with Jesus? And that should be the influence that you and I are going to make in this community in which God has placed this New Testament church, in which God has given you a godly pastor. God has given you a great pastor that preaches the word of God here. Amen? Amen. Thank God for Brother Jim. There's a lot of churches that do not have God's men behind pulpits. Jesus said, many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. And there's many pulpits today that there's no more gospel coming out from behind them than anything else that goes in. So if you've got a godly pastor, there's another godly pastor right there in the back, Brother Russell Hagler. Now he's going to preach the word of God. Dear precious brother, dear precious friend, I tell you what, if you love Jesus and you preach and proclaim Jesus, you're going to be one of my best friends, I tell you. You're not going to be a threat to me. Are we a threat to others when we go out? Well, if I answer no to that question, I better reevaluate myself. Number one, I better reevaluate myself to make sure that I'm in the faith. Amen. And then what Paul said to the Corinthian believers, the immature church, in 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourself to make sure you're in the faith. Prove your own self. Know you're not your own self. And that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be a reprobate. Who's Paul writing to? He's writing to believers. He's writing to those that are saved. And he's saying to saved people to examine yourself, not examine your neighbor, not examine your wife, not examine your children. Examine yourself to make sure you're in the faith. Amen? And he said that to believers. So we have the warning there. Don't die and go to hell being a church member sitting in a pew for 60 years but never have been born of the Spirit of God. Amen? Amen. I'll tell you, we had a deacon in my first church that had been a deacon for years and years and years. in one Sunday. And I'll tell you what, if there was ever somebody saved, I would say that he was one of the saints of God. And one Sunday, he walked down the aisle, and he came up to me. I didn't know what was going on. I thought there must be something wrong in his family. And he told me I need to get saved. I tell you what, I didn't know what to do. I'd never encountered anybody like that before. I didn't know, what do you do when a church member that's been a church member year after year, that's been a deacon year after year, comes up and says that he wants to be saved? You know what I said? Well, let me show you the Word of God, what you must do to be saved. And you know what happened? He did and got saved. And I tell you what, he was an influence for Christ before he was saved in his religion. But I tell you what, after he got saved, whoo, I tell you, it was like 9 day difference. It was like 9 day difference. So examine yourself to make sure you are in the faith. I don't know about you, but I certainly want to walk in the steps of Jesus. I know those are big shoes, and every foot of every human being that ever lived could not put all their feet together in one of Jesus' sandals. Amen? Not one. But I tell you what, we better try to. We better act like we're trying to get in those shoes, and we better walk like Jesus walked, and we better pray that others recognize that we've not only been with Jesus, but Jesus has been with us. Amen?
Amen.
Am I a threat to others that I come in contact with? If not, I better do some examination. And that doesn't mean that we try to be ugly or mean to anyone, but what that does mean is we're going to tell them the truth, that the only way they can be saved is to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. The next morning, verse 12, they come into Jerusalem. There is the triumphal entry from verses 12 to verse 19. We have that Passion Week. It's amazing when we think of the Passion Week, because out of the four Gospels, you've got 89 chapters in all of your Gospels. 29 and a half of those chapters pertain to the last week, what we call the Passion Week. That is amazing. As a matter of fact, almost half of John's Gospel is concerning the last week of the Lord Jesus Christ. I call it a week and a day because he comes in on Sunday, and we have 7 days, and that gets us back through the Sabbath day. Jesus is in the tomb on the Sabbath day, the seventh day, but then early in the morning on the first day of the week, Jesus is resurrected from the dead, which would be day number eight. So that Passion Week, I call it the long week, and all of the activity that took place, the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember when Jesus began his ministry in John chapter 2? What did he do when he began his ministry? Well, he was baptized, and then what did he do? Well, he went into the temple, he went in the court of the Gentiles, and he run out all the money changers, and those that were selling sacrificial animals, and those that were exchanging money. He runs them all out at the beginning of his ministry. What does he do at the end of his ministry? At the end of his ministry, at the end of about 3.5 years, he comes into Jerusalem. What does he do on that day when he comes in? He goes into the temple and he clears them out again. He runs out the money changers and those that are selling sacrificial animals. He begins his ministry by cleansing the temple. He ends his ministry by cleansing the temple. And isn't it sad, between those 3.5 years, nothing really changed during the ministry of Christ. How do you know that? Because when his ministry is finished, he has to go back in and cleanse it again. Amen. So you and I better beware. We better be on our toes. Amen. We better be ready to give a reason of the hope that is in us with fear and with trembling. Amen. So Lazarus gives us a marvelous, marvelous influence of a preserving influence, a sustaining influence, that's seen by the bread, by an illuminating influence, that's by the light, and by an ongoing influence, which we see in Abel, and really all that's in the Bible that God has given us by record. We can go back and we can be influenced by their ongoing ministries. Amen. I would invite you, if you've never trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, and my prayer would be that God would reveal your sin to you right now, and that he would show you through the scriptures, not through what I said, but through the scriptures, that your only hope is Christ. I pray for those that are watching, those that are here. I pray for you that are Christians, that have been born of the Spirit of God. I pray that you would examine yourself to make sure you're in the faith, and to make sure that you leave this place knowing that you're saved. And I pray that if there's any movement that you need to make, any movement that I need to make, as God has given me instructions, I pray that I would do that. We're going to have an invitation time. You're going to have opportunity to come. If you'd like to come and pray, just social distance, come and pray. If you'd like to say some words to me or Brother Jordan, whatever it is, if God has given you instructions, make sure that you honor those instructions before you leave this place. If you're watching by Facebook or YouTube and you're saved by the grace of God, you're going to need a church home. You're going to need a church family that will love you. I invite you to come to this local assembly here at Daleville Baptist Church. And I pray that you would come here and unite with this group of believers, and that you would come in here and work with them. I know they'll love you, and they'll welcome you into the church, but you need to do that. So let's pray together. Father, we thank you. As this time invitation comes, I pray that, Lord, I would examine myself. Lord, I pray that I would examine myself. Lord, I'm not looking for nobody else. I'm looking for me. And Lord, the instructions that you have for me through this message, I pray that I would take heed of those instructions. And those that are here, and those that are watching on Facebook or YouTube, I pray that right now that they would take heed to the instructions that you're giving to them. Whether it's to be saved, whether it's to dedicate their life, whether it's to make a commitment, whether it's to confess, whatever it is, Lord, I pray right now that as we give opportunity, that your people would respond in a mighty way, and that many people would be saved. And we ask it all in the name of Jesus, for his glory and for his sake. Amen.
Jim is on vacation, and he'll be headed back soon. I have a few announcements to go over, and we'll get us out of here. This upcoming Saturday, Saturday, April 3rd, we're having our Easter egg hunt. I encourage you to come. Bring your children. Grade 6 and under are going to be able to hunt eggs, and the rest of us are going to fellowship and hide eggs and hang out. It'll be a good time. And then the very next morning, Easter morning, we're going to have two services, 8:30 and 10:30. Come to both. We're going to have a good morning, a good time there. And then I was also told to let everyone know that this upcoming Wednesday, March 31st at 6 p.m., the children are going to be doing their musical in here. I encourage you to come, be a part of that. Watch that with them. And then to help raise some money for camp, they are going to be having a spaghetti dinner, right downstairs afterwards, taking donations for camp. I encourage you to come, watch, support them and the ministry Ms. Darby is having. So again, thank you, Brother Dennis, for being here this morning. I'm going to make this also known. Thank you, Brother Danny, and all those who helped pressure wash the roundabout out there. If you wonder why it looks so clean, it's because he did a good job. So thank you, Brother Danny, for that. Be in prayer, Brother Jim. Yeah, you can clap for that. Be in prayer, Brother Jim, as they're on their way back soon, and we will have a good afternoon. If you need me or Ms. Darby, please don't hesitate to call. Mr. McClendon, would you close us in prayer?
Dear Father, thank you for this day, and thank you, dear Lord, for bringing this preacher, dear Lord. Dear Lord, thank you for letting me preach the word. And dear God, as we come to you on this Palm Sunday, and as he explains why it is the Palm Sunday, dear Lord, and we thank you that you did send your son, that we can all be together one day, dear Lord, and that's what it's all about. As we studied in Sunday school, dear Lord, we appreciate everything that you do for us and the, how you put everything together and that as you sent the colt, dear Lord, that hadn't been rode and dear Lord, the significance of that and dear Lord, all the trip was planned from the beginning to the end and that you knew what was going to happen and how it was going to happen. And dear Lord, may our minds comprehend that and come together with that. Dear God, I pray for the people in this church and the people that have problems and that are having trials, dear Lord, this week. And we pay a special blessing on them and the sickness. And we know that everybody has a different set of problems, dear Lord. And just put your hand upon them and lead and guide and direct us as we go through this week. And as we come to Resurrection Sunday, dear Lord, that we realize the importance of that and what it means in our lives, that we all can have eternity and that we don't have to burn in hell. Lead, guide, direct us to go through this week. For these things we ask in Christ, in his name, amen.